Welcome to Protecting the Right to Protest, Free Speech versus Corporate Power at the Vancouver Public Library. We are pleased to present this evening in partnership with the BC Civil Liberties Association. My name is Kyla, and I have the pleasure of serving as the chair of the Vancouver Public Library Board. I'd like to begin this evening by acknowledging that we are gathered here this evening on the traditional and unceded territories of the Musqueam, Squamish, and Tsleil-Waututh Nations. Tonight's discussion will explore our rights of free speech and the corporate assault on these democratic rights. I'm personally very excited about this event because I feel it will encourage all of us to ask ourselves questions and explore new ideas, both of which are vital. We are delighted that our speakers this evening are Josh Patterson, Executive Director of the BC Civil Liberties Association, Linda Solomon-Wood, Editor-in-Chief of the National Observer, Alan Dutton, Canadian Anti-Racism Education and Research Society, and Michael Bond, Policy Director at the BC Civil Liberties Association. I just want to highlight, before we turn to tonight's event, some other events coming up at the library. I'll mention just one, which is on Tuesday, February 28th. You can join us for Intellectual Freedom and the Arts, a panel discussion with Hassan Namir, author of God in Pink, Matt Troy, artist and executive director of the Vancouver Art and Leisure Society, and Sarinda Bogle, who is the chief librarian of Surrey Public Library. You can find all this information on our website, bpl.ca, on the table over here, or from one of our wonderful staff that are here this evening as well. A couple of housekeeping items. If you need to leave the room for any reason, please do so at the back door. That includes if you have to go out to use the washrooms and come back in that way. If you could turn off anything that makes noise or might disturb this evening, that would be great to do that now. And then I'm very pleased to introduce to you one of BPL's staff people. I love all of our staff, they're so amazing. Derek Christian is from the BPL Programming and Learning Department and will be moderating this evening's discussion. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Kyla, for the introductions, and thank you to the BC Civil Liberties Association for collaborating on this event with the library tonight. Today's format, we're going to have each of our esteemed speakers speak one by one. I'll introduce each one as we go. Just to save time, we're going to ask that you leave your questions till the end of the evening after each speaker has spoken, and we'll have a little Q&A session, which should be fun. Our first speaker I'll introduce, I'm happy to do it, is Josh Patterson. Josh Patterson joined the BC Civil Liberties Association as its executive director in January of 2013. His legal career has focused on protecting some of the most marginalized people in Canada from human rights violations, civil liberties restrictions, discrimination, and environmental injustice. Prior to joining the BCCLA, Josh worked as an Aboriginal and natural resources lawyer, working to protect the rights of people in northern and coastal BC communities. He worked as a labor and human rights lawyer, working on one of BC's largest racial discrimination cases in history, and also as the director of Freedom of Expression, Quality and Dignity Project at the Canadian Civil Liberties Association. He's also a founding board member of the Vancouver Public Spaces Network, which he served for many years as the coordinator for surveillance and security issues. Please welcome Josh Patterson.
Thank you very much, and thanks to the Vancouver Public Library for inviting us to collaborate on this wonderful event tonight. We're always happy to have an opportunity to collaborate with the library. I want to thank our hosts as well for acknowledging that we are gathered tonight on unceded lands. BCCLA, as one of Canada's oldest and largest human rights organizations, is committed to the full realization of the rights of Indigenous peoples, and so that recognition of territory for us is very meaningful. For those of you who aren't familiar with the BC Civil Liberties Association, we work on a whole lot of different issues, including democratic rights, the right to protest, discrimination issues, police accountability issues, national security, privacy rights, and many, many more. We have quite a wide range of things that we work on, and we do that in a bunch of different ways. One of the noteworthy ways that we do that is through litigation, and so some of you may be familiar with some of the big cases that we've litigated over time, including the assisted dying case, which was a BCCLA case, the challenge to mass online surveillance at all times by the federal government is one of our cases as well that's ongoing, challenge to solitary confinement. So litigation is an important way in which we do our work. Education is another important way that we do our work. Talking to people in events like this evening, talking through the media, going around the province, giving workshops, these kinds of things. Advocacy and law reform, actually advocating with government directly for changes to policy. And at BCCLA, we have long believed, as you would not surprise you for a civil liberties organization, that protest is a critical part of our free expression and assembly rights. And some of the earliest things that we got involved in as an association involved protest rights, notably the Gastown riots in 1971. Some of you may have been to Woodward's downtown and seen the large photo montage or the photo art that's in there of the Gastown riots. And it was volunteers at the BCCLA who were among civil society, some of the first responders in that instance. And of course, over the years, we've done many other things. Protest, demonstration, and dissent advance critical conversations about public policy, about government accountability. And we've protected those rights in our most fundamental laws because they are the bedrock of a healthy democracy. The rights to protest and to assemble are among our most cherished rights. In recent years, we've seen lots of different threats posed to those rights, from spying on protesters and surveillance of protesters, whether through C-51 or even before C-51, plenty of surveillance of particularly protesters and demonstrators against resource development projects in BC. Just this past weekend, we've heard from people in Prince Rupert who were being harassed because they were wearing anti-LNG t-shirts at a First Nations basketball tournament. And the organizers didn't like that, but it's in a civically owned property. So what are the rights of the organizers of the private event to enforce against people's free expression in the stands or against team members or these kinds of things? And lots more. Providing legal observers for protests is one of the things we've done over time because we're really committed to that. It's very difficult for us to actually manage to do that all around the province. And giving protest rights workshops is another thing that we do. And today, what we're talking about together is the private threat to free expression in this province through the use of the law, through slap suits, through what are known as strategic lawsuits against public participation. Lawsuits that have as their effect to penalize citizens for participating in public affairs and have as their effect to deter others from that kind of participation. Usually when we think as civil liberties organizations about threats to freedom of expression, we're always thinking about government. And our organization is always sort of pitched at what government is doing. What slap suits do is they use an institution of the state, they use the power of the state and of the legal system in a private effort that winds up, whether intentionally or not, silencing people's participation. And as Michael will discuss, the fact that these can infringe on people's rights without intending to do so is critically important for us to remember. Slaps can come in a variety of forms. It could come in the form of a legal action, or it could just come in the form of a threat. And that's not necessarily a lawsuit, but it has the same effect. Because these kinds of lawsuits are permissible in British Columbia, oftentimes the threat or a threatening letter will be what achieves the effect of shutting people up. And they've been used, as I'm sure many of you in this room know, to target local residents, citizens groups, to target even sometimes First Nations, to target individuals, to target protesters, for doing things ranging from full-on demonstration, getting in the way of things, through to writing letters to the editor, through to organizing groups on Facebook, through to speaking up at municipal council meetings. All of these various things, through to writing things in newspapers as journalists, all of these different things have been targets at one time or another of this kind of litigation in BC. Across North America, we've seen lots of varieties of these. Sometimes it's to do with online publication. Sometimes people call those cyber slaps. There are the veggie libel slap suits. The most famous one of those was actually Oprah Winfrey in the United States, who said that she didn't want to eat hamburgers anymore. During the mad cow crisis, she had a panel on beef, and she said, "Oh, this has really turned me off of eating hamburgers." She wound up in one of the biggest, most prominent slap suits in United States history. It actually forced her to move her show to Austin, Texas for a number of months so she could defend the lawsuit. And it was in Austin, Texas, by the way, where she met Dr. Phil, put him on the show, and Dr. Phil emerged actually from a slap suit, but that's another story. There are public servant slaps where, not so much governments these days, because case law prohibits this in BC and in other provinces, but where senior officials in government, as themselves, as employees, actually launch suits against citizens in their municipalities. And usually this is, we've only seen this happening at the municipal level. And in some instances, having those lawsuits being indemnified, or the costs of bringing those lawsuits being supported by the employer, by the municipality. So a clever way of getting around the bar against government bringing defamation suits is you can have your city manager do it, or that kind of thing. So these come in all different varieties. And just how pervasive a problem it is really difficult to measure. Because most slap suits or threatened slap suits achieve their goal long before they ever get to a judge. It's that threatening letter where someone shuts up and we never hear about it, and the media never hears about it, no one ever hears about it, because they've shut up and they don't talk about it anymore. It is often the case that these things just fly beneath the radar. They stay below the level of public consciousness, and yet they have a profound censoring effect. We receive calls very often from people who, and other legal organizations do as well, it's not just us, who receive calls from people who've gotten letters from a developer saying, I don't want you to keep showing up at these public meetings. I don't want you to keep criticizing. It can be small things, you know. We've seen instances where it's not necessarily a huge mine or a hydroelectric dam, but it can be something as simple as your new development actually is going to mean that a path that all of us neighbors use for walking isn't any longer accessible, so I'm opposed to the development. And we've seen threats from developers for things like that to people who are just in their neighborhood concerned about where they can walk. Want to talk about that to their city councils, and then don't because of the threats. We've seen First Nations and their neighbors in the Northwest recently being threatened in relation to LNG, and not just people who are standing in the stands of basketball tournaments, but people who are talking in their communities and who are organizing being threatened. We've seen citizens and activists in the Lower Mainland who are concerned about coal exports being threatened this way. We've seen senior citizens on Vancouver Island concerned about developments in their neighborhoods. We've seen farmers and First Nations people in the northeast of the province, in the Peace River, with a lawsuit hung over their head by a Crown agency, no less, by BC Hydro. And this is a very special, for us, a very special category of problem in terms of slap suits, because for the government can't do this itself, but for a Crown corporation acting in the, owned by the government, acting, we would argue, in the place of the government, to use lawsuits to stifle people's expression, to stifle people's opposition, to us is reprehensible. And all of that is possible in BC because in BC we have no anti-slap legislation and haven't had since our government got rid of it almost as soon as we had had anti-slap legislation in 2002. And my colleague Michael is going to talk more about that. We have a serious problem in this province with free expression, with the right to protest, and it doesn't just come from governments, and it is something we need to address, and that's what we're going to be hearing more about this evening. And I think next up is, am I introducing the next person? Forgive me, I didn't get the memo. We'll move on. It's Linda.
Yes.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thanks, Joe.
We have Alan Dutton, who is a member of the Canadian Anti-Racism Education and Research Society. Alan is an expert on anti-democratic movements, right-wing extremism, Nazi organizations, and the impact of racism on individuals, institutions, and society. He specializes in methods to help recover from recruitment into political extremist groups. To help youth recover from those aspects. He's also received the Mosaic Human Rights Award, an award for combating racism from the Attorney General of BC, and an award of appreciation for government service from the ministry responsible for multiculturalism and integration of BC. Please welcome Alan Dutton.
Thank you very much, and again, I want to say thank you very much for inviting me to speak tonight from both the Vancouver Public Library and BCCLA, both really important to all of us here in BC. I have some notes, and I'll see how well I do following the structure that I wanted to outline. I'm very happy to be here tonight to talk about slap suits, because they're one of the most serious issues that we have to deal with. We're going to protect democratic rights. Canadians fought for the right to freedom of expression, freedom of assembly, and the right to protest. And we have a Charter of Rights and Freedoms and a Constitution, and Canada has signed a series of international treaties to protect civil and political rights. But we don't get those protections. And my cases, the case against me in terms of Kendra Morgan, and also in terms of a radio station, which I think will help to demonstrate that we have a long way to go to protect our rights and what we need to do in terms of our organizing and mobilizing communities against hate. The issue of slap suits was put very simply by the Burnaby Now. It's a local newspaper in Burnaby that extensively covered the Kinder Morgan issues and the demonstration against Kinder Morgan. And the Burnaby Now said, warned, quote, "The fact that you can sue a group of people, claim millions in damages, and blame a few in the crowd for the acts committed by the whole is alarming. What happens if you are at a protest and someone throws a brick through a window? Could you be sued because you're an easy target to pick out of the crowd?" Dutton, myself. They were referring to me because this opinion piece was published just after I lost an appeal to have Kinder Morgan slap suit against myself and a few other people dismissed. Dutton took this case on to stand up for the freedom of expression and the right to protest, but the judge's decision in my appeal raises serious questions about how we can exercise those rights. And that's the critical matter. We have rights on paper, but we, as we've heard a little bit here, we have a failure to implement those rights, to protect our rights. This warning by the Burnaby Now is important because it clearly recognizes that Kinder Morgan's lawsuit against a number of protesters was an attack not only on my democratic rights, but on the democratic rights of everyone in BC. Against rights, against speaking out, protesting, and assembly. Given the present state of the law, even if there isn't a shred of evidence against you, you can be charged. And those charges, when you try to defend yourself, will cost you tens of thousands of dollars. So it's intimidation. And so, based on my experience, and I'll stop reading in a few minutes here, but based on my experience, having faced two slap suits, and I'll talk about those a little bit in detail, I argue that the purpose of a slap is not to protect a valid legal claim, but rather to frighten and silence those who are bold enough to criticize, to question, and to speak out. Slaps turn court cases into weapons in a political war over democratic rights versus corporate profit. Protesters who have legitimate concerns are suddenly turned into defendants who must prove their innocence against multi-million dollar corporations or powerful interests. In short, slaps force public disputes into the private realm of the courts, where advocates become defendants and must pay tens of thousands of dollars simply to defend their right to freedom of expression and to protest. As such, slaps are a corporate assault on democratic rights. Now, I'll talk a little bit about a couple of cases. The first case against myself was when I was working for the Canadian Anti-Racism Education Research Society. You heard a little bit about that in the introduction. It's an organization that tracks and monitors hate groups, and I do research. So, it turned out that a radio station in British Columbia, in the Lower Mainland, as a matter of fact, was providing a forum for racists to recruit. Now, many people, I think, would have been very worried about saying that, and a lot of newspapers would be worried about printing that. But I said it, and the Western Jewish Bulletin printed it, and so did the Georgia Strait. Guess who got sued? I got sued, and the Western Jewish Bulletin got sued, but guess what? The Georgia Strait didn't get sued. Clearly, there were some concerns about what this radio station was doing. But nevertheless, they started proceedings against us. Fortunately, we had a lawyer on our board of directors, Don Crane, Rush Crane, Gunther and Adams. And Don Crane defended us and actually went into discovery. And it turned out the radio station, because of the wealth of evidence against them, and because, I think mainly, not just because of the evidence, I think mainly they settled and paid our court costs. They settled because they feared the weight of public opinion. And I think that's critical in terms of Kinder Morgan. If you're going to fight slap suits, you can't do it alone. You must have mobilized population, mobilized communities, and you must have media attention. You know, what's happening in many of these cases, as people have alluded to before, is that people receive a threatening letter saying they're going to be sued, and it shuts them up. Now, sometimes it's wise to shut up, but if we're going to retain our democratic rights, some of us are going to have to speak out and take a risk. Now, in order to protect the people that are taking a risk, we have to stand up. And in the case, in my case, in Burnaby Mountain, and the case, there were actually five people that were sued. I was sued personally and as a representative of a community organization. And it cost each defendant tens of thousands of dollars to defend themselves. So you're looking at five people, It probably costs, I don't know the exact numbers, but you're looking at $200,000. And that's not including my application to have the case dismissed as a slap suit. People stood up and they donated money and they came out and they protested in front of the courthouse and they protested on Burnaby Mountain against Kinder Morgan. This case raised the stakes for Kinder Morgan. Now, there was a lot to do with a case by Kinder Morgan against the five of us. There were demonstrations on Burnaby Mountain, and there were people that actually set up some tents, and there were people that marched, and there were people that demonstrated. But there were minor significance. There were dozens of police officers on that mountain, and there were tons of security agents on that mountain. And there was very little to be concerned about. The issue was that Kinder Morgan wanted to drill, to test drill in a conservation area. And they applied for an injunction to stop the demonstrations and to prevent people from being in the area where they wanted to drill. Now, I was included in the five people that were sued because I was well known. I had been involved in demonstrating against Kinder Morgan since 2013, and I'd organized town halls and forums, and I'd spoken in the newspapers, and I'd created a website, and I had a Facebook page. And so I was well known, and so I was sued. I was one of those people in the crowd that was sued because I was well known. I'd argued for demonstrations that were family friendly, because if you're gonna have major demonstrations, you can't get them unless you have a lot of people. And of course, if you're going to have a lot of violence, then you're going to discourage people from coming. So I was arguing all the time that we had to have some rules and some ability to make sure that it was going to be safe for people to be there. Now, despite that, I was sued for. I'd like to read it, but I don't have the time right now. I was sued for about five or six or seven different things. Assault, trespass, interference with contractual arrangements, and a bunch of other things. Oh, and conspiracy. Conspiracy was the big one. That I conspired to have some kind of damages done to Kinder Morgan. Of course I was involved in organizing. Of course I was asking people to show up on the mountain. Of course I was asking people to monitor what was going on, that Kinder Morgan was clear-cutting an area in a conservation zone. Of course I wanted people to take pictures, but there was no evidence whatsoever against me in terms of physical assault, trespass, intimidation, or conspiracy to do harm. Absolutely none whatsoever. Still, the judge ruled that there was prima facie evidence against me, and it was sufficient to go to court. Now, I appealed and said, and my lawyer said on my behalf, there's no evidence against Dudley. What have you got? They said, well, they have, the answer is evidence, just two things. One was a Facebook post encouraging people to go to the mountain to protest, to demonstrate, and to monitor. So, a post on a Facebook page that I managed was evidence of my involvement in conspiracy, assault, trespass, and everything else. And from there, the judge in the case where I appealed Kinder Morgan's decision, he said that in a very short three-page decision, he said that he had no choice but to take the first judge's decision that there was prima facie evidence against me for all these issues, and that there was no evidence, or there was no proof, there's no evidence that this was a slap suit, because a slap suit involves the intention to deprive somebody of their civil rights, their democratic rights. And the judge found there was no evidence. The judge found that it was simply Kinder Morgan's case against me and that it should go to trial. Now, strangely enough, the weight of public opinion and the media coverage had turned, strangely enough, turned totally against Kinder Morgan. There were daily TV news shots and newspapers writing about the demonstrations, and a lot of positive, like the Vertebe now, a lot of positive reports. So Kinder Morgan had offered to discontinue the civil suit against the five of us. Two accepted because they were obviously concerned and afraid that they were going to lose, you know, substantial amounts of money besides the court costs. So they decided they would accept the discontinuance. I thought it was totally wrong to accept the discontinuance, and that we should continue fighting. So, in that case, we were left. There were three of us left, and my charges were mounting. But the negative publicity, as I said before, in the case of the radio station, the negative publicity was the decisive factor in forcing Kinder Morgan to unilaterally discontinue the court case. Because Kinder Morgan ordered a unilateral discontinuance, that forced Kinder Morgan to have to pay part of my court costs. So while the newspaper said that I had lost my appeal to have the case dismissed, Kinder Morgan did suffer a little bit of inconvenience in terms of payment, and they lost, I think, they lost more in terms of the media turning against them, because a lot of the media at this point were saying that, look, you know, this is totally insane for Kinder Morgan to be suing this group of people for what's happening on Burden Mountain. I think I should probably end there, but so you have two cases, a radio station and a major Texas oil company suing a person without any evidence whatsoever that would stand up in court, but a judge allowing it to go forward simply because there's a bias in the court system to allow cases to go to trial. Okay, everybody should have a chance, you know, everybody should have the opportunity to go to trial. But in this case, when there's no evidence, or such flimsy evidence, where it's obvious to everybody that there is nothing but www.stopslawsuits.ca, and if you want to see my recommendations for legislation, please go there. Now, what we're suggesting is that the issue of proving intent is a non-starter, that it should not be included in legislation. It should be legislation to affirm our rights, the freedom of expression, freedom of assembly, and that is the way that the bill should come forward. And I'm sure that if we have an NDP government in May, that we'll be able to enjoy anti-slap legislation like they do in Quebec, like they do in Ontario, and like they do in a majority of states in the USA. Well, BC had anti-slap legislation, as Josh mentioned, in 2001. As soon as the Liberals came into power, they revoked that legislation. Guess who was the Attorney General? Jeff Platt. And guess where Jeff Platt works right now? He's an advisor on environmental issues to Christy Clark, and he works for a major, strangely enough, he works for a major law corporation that happens to be involved in environmental issues. Thank you very much.
Next up, our final speaker is Michael Vaughan. Michael is a lawyer and has been policy director of the BCCLA since 2004. She's an adjunct professor at UBC in the Faculty of Law, and also in the School of Library, Archival, and Information Studies, where she has taught civil liberties and information ethics. a regular guest instructor for UB's College of Health Disciplines and interdisciplinary elective in HIV case care as well. She has been honored for her work in HIV/AIDS and for her support and guidance given to the BC Library community. Michael is currently a collaborator on big data surveillance, a multi-year research projected lead by Queen's University. And lastly, she is an advisory board member of Ryerson University's Center for Free Expression and Privacy International. Everyone, welcome. Please join me welcoming Michael Vaughn.
Hello. Well, here I am with the honor of telling you some of the things that might be done, what can be done. The BCCLA is a nonpartisan organization. We don't care what government brings in anti-SLAPP legislation, but we're determined to see it. And I'm here to talk to you a little bit about what anti-SLAPP legislation looks like. So we have a campaign to educate people about the need for an anti-SLAPP legislation. And the good news is that we have a very good example of what we think is probably effective anti-SLAPP legislation, and that was recently introduced in Ontario. We have a model of what it is that we are looking to see. So I'm going to walk you through some of the essential elements of what this legislation is, because I must say it's very counterintuitive. When we think about access to justice, we're thinking about trying to get people into the courts, not trying to get people out of the courts. But this is courts, as Alan was saying, courts weaponized. When big resources can attack little resources because they can afford to be there and you can't. So what in the process can help screen out these offensive kinds of lawsuits? So I want to acknowledge that in this field, what we know about some of the effective elements come from a blue ribbon panel that was assessed, collated, if you will, put together in Ontario. The Ontario legislature had put together a blue ribbon panel of people to look at what are the effective elements. And also, Dr. Chris Tollefson at the University of Victoria is trailblazing in the field of anti-SLAPP legislation. So, the first thing that I want to talk about in effective anti-SLAPP legislation, because as Alan was saying, we had legislation in British Columbia, and if you missed it, it was because we only had it for 8 minutes, right? Okay, so that seems like the bad news, although it wasn't very effective legislation. So it's not like we're missing a big piece here, okay? It wasn't effective because, as Alan was saying, the clear weakness, the limitation of that legislation that we do not want to repeat. In the old law, the burden was on the person being sued to prove an improper purpose. Okay, so we start with the notion here. What you're doing is you're interposing a process before the trial. You're trying to screen out the punishment of going to the trial by saying this is one of those kinds of suits that the courts need to examine more carefully. And again, as Alan was pointing out, courts have an inherent jurisdiction to dismiss frivolous and vexatious lawsuits. But the standard for that is incredibly high. So as he was saying, so they brought nothing, they had no evidence, they had a Facebook page. And the judge said, yep, that means that, yeah, that gets over the hurdle, right? Very hard to have something thrown out of court in that purview. So we want an effective screen. What does that screen look like? And the first thing, as I say, is the burden cannot be on the person being sued to prove what is in the heart of the person who is suing them, to prove that they have an improper motive. So it's like trying to demonstrate to the court that you can effectively read someone's mind. As my colleague Josh Patterson was saying, unless they've actually said into a secret microphone, twirling their mustache, wah-ha-ha-ha, I'm going to get them to shut up, right? And you have the recording somehow. What on earth would you bring to prove what is in their heart and why they're doing it, right? The whole point of a slap suit, if it's going to be effective, is that you have an effective disguise for censoring someone. And the disguise is whatever your cause of action is. You trespassed, you defamed me, you whatever the case be. You've got it covered. So trying to get around that, you have to have a different measure. And so to be effective, we say, to adjudicate this effectively, what you judge at this point is not what is in the heart of the person bringing the lawsuit, but what is the effect on the person whose speech is being silenced. So this is just like the whole realm of human rights anti-discrimination, right? If you're looking at a discrimination case, you don't say at the Human Rights Tribunal on discrimination, by the by, were you planning to be racist? Were you planning to be sexist? Is that what's going on here? No, the point is that doesn't matter. The effect on the person is what matters. Because of course the effect could be intentional or unintentional. But if you look at this from the point that what counts is the effect and not the motive, then what you've got is you've got a more effective screening mechanism, because what we're screening here for is the ability to participate in the public discourse. So what matters is not what anybody is trying to do, but what you are unable to do on the basis of their actions. So the threshold question in effective anti-slap legislation is whether the expression that is giving rise to the underlying action, whatever they sued you for, trespass, defamation, contractual breach, whatever it is, whether the expression giving rise to that suit is on a matter of public interest. Okay. The question of what constitutes a matter of public interest, in case you've already leapt ahead going, I wonder if that's tricky in law. No, it isn't actually. And I say it isn't because it's not obscure in law. We see this in a number of cases, especially around things like that you might not consider. Access to information. Okay, if you make an access to information request and you say, I need a fee waiver because they're going to charge me $8 billion for what it is I'm asking for, these records. And you say, well, I want a waiver because this is in the public interest. The way you would demonstrate that, really, is you'd show up with a series of clippings. We're talking about this in the news. See, people are talking about this. This is a matter of public interest. It's not difficult to demonstrate. It's not obscure. It's not something that you have to adjudicate by standards that are unknown, or that ordinary people couldn't simply, with their computer, develop the evidentiary basis for demonstrating that something is in the public interest. So it's not obscure in law. A burden that would not prove onerous in respect to slaps is key. So the burden, again, having this essential, because what you're looking to do ultimately is reverse the burden. So the first burden is on you to demonstrate that your expression rights have been curtailed because your speech, in this case, was a matter of public interest. So if we've got that squarely there, then the whole point of this exercise is to shift the burden after you've met your portion, so that the party that has sued you now has to demonstrate that their claim has substantial merit and that there are substantial grounds to believe that you have no valid defense. So again, the point here is that this is a screen or a filter to truncate this entire process, right? This tens of thousands of dollars of months and months and months of heartache of going through this process. To truncate it down to what you have to prove, your rights have been imperiled because you were speaking on a matter of public interest, shifts over to the suer to show that that they have substantial merit in what they're dealing with. So that would be them showing up with their evidence, that question. So one, showing that the expression at issue is a matter of public interest, then you shift. And now, of course, you've got the screen. So this screen is obviously not as onerous as a regular trial, certainly not on you. Now, keep in mind, you are still essentially being slapped. You are in court to do this, right? This is an intervening court process meant to act as that screen and filter out the worst effects of a slap. Anti-slap legislation does not actually prevent anyone from slapping you. What it tries to do is it tries to minimize the effect of a slap so that we can reduce the element of that process, that protracted punishing process on you, so that you're better able to withstand the silencing, right? So that's the effect. So there are other procedural protections, though, that are vital to effective anti-slap legislation. So you want things like short deadlines for the plaintiff's reply and filing of their materials. No waiting 6 months down the road, this hanging over your head, still not sure if you can continue to speak, afraid to talk to the reporters, not sure what you could do now. No, 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 court filing times. Again, we're trying to make the process truncated so that it is not as punishing on the person whose rights are affected. You want an expedited hearing. You want an automatic full suspension of the underlying action while this mini process is happening. And so, with all of that in place, there's still the question, while we're thinking about big resources and little resources, of how to create the economic disincentive for filing slap. So you might reduce the punishment of the process, which is part of this, but in terms of actually making an effective disincentive, other than, look, we might be able to do this mini process and get out of here quicker, what else can we do? One of the ways to make a disincentive economically is to give automatic full indemnification for costs to the successful defendant, right? So you actually do make the ability to get back your costs part of, again, this mini process. An automatic award of compensatory damages for breach of expressive rights is another possibility. And the possibility of a discretionary award of punitive damages where the court is satisfied that the plaintiff was indeed attempting to punish, silence, or intimidate the defendant. Okay, again, the problem with the old British Columbia 8-minute-long tenure of legislation in anti-slap world was that it started at that point. In what we're proposing as a better model, that's at the issue of punitive damages. That's not where you start having to prove something to get yourself out of this process. That's a punitive damages question, where you can actually prove an intent, where the judge is satisfied that the point of this exercise was to silence. And finally, of course, there should be a substantive measure that deems that communication made in the public interest to be an occasion of qualified privilege for the purposes of claims of defamation. So if it wasn't clear before, although we're seeing a massive amount of creativity now with slap suits, there certainly was a time when defamation was the go-to slap. So we would be interested in looking at, and the association has long been interested in looking at, how we might craft better defamation laws in addition to everything else that we're talking about in the anti-slap legislation realm. So, what do I want to say here? I want to go over to, with this legislative proposal, as I say, Ontario stands as a very good model for what we might have. We're nowhere near it at this moment. We're a little disappointed to say that what seems to be in the discussion today, some excitement, that there that there are platforms now that are going into the election that are going to talk about anti-SLAPP legislation. It doesn't appear that they're talking about what I'm going to call now the Ontario model, which is kind of the things that I'm outlining to you. They sound a little more like what we had before that we now know is not really very effective. Right? So we don't want to lose this opportunity to reintroduce the kind of legislation that we know will not work and will serve only as window dressing. Right? If we're going to get anti-SLAPP legislation in BC, and we have the opportunity now because Ontario really has led the way in having fairly effective, we think, we're going to find out there's going to be all kinds of bumps in the road, but as a model considered to be the best in Canada, right? We want to talk about the harmonization of these kinds of laws across the country. And again, we don't want to be, and I remember very, very well, when there were SLAPPs in 2004, 2005, and the then Attorney General made as public comment in the media, because they were egregious SLAPPs. Oh my God, one of them involved somebody who was sued for defamation for something they said in their own living room that was recorded, that was recorded by an undercover detective that was sent by the corporation in question. It was one of the most egregious cases I've ever heard of. It's breath bereaving what happened. And I listened as we were kind of doing point counterpoint in the media with the then Attorney General, as I, speaking on behalf of the BC Civil Liberties Association, was calling for anti-SLAPP legislation, the AG straight face saying the courts are fully equipped to deal with these kinds of suits. This person had lost both at the Court of First Instance and at the Court of Appeal on what is literally a breath-bereaving set of facts. So we have long known this. We have a unique opportunity right now to do a number of things, to tell people stories. We've heard some stories tonight. There are other stories. Can I tell you how difficult it is for people to tell stories when they're afraid that anything that they might say might be added to the suit against them right now, or might reintroduce another suit? In fact, we've had to talk about getting pro bono counsel to advise people who might want to tell their stories about these things. And you can see how this trap works, right? You can see how this trap works. So we need to get out of this. And one of the things we need to do is we need to tell people why this is an important issue. We want to tell people why now is an important opportunity. Again, we've got the Ontario model. We've got political parties looking to look good. Let's give them something to look good about. Let's tell them not only what we want, but what it should look like and what would be the best model. And that we don't want the cheap one we had before because we already know it's broken. How about the good one? And again, we don't have far to point. You could just cut and paste it and you would have the best anti-SLAPP legislation that this province had ever seen. And while we're thinking about how we want to get better in the world, we might also remind the government of British Columbia or any other province that doesn't have anti-SLAPP legislation that places like Texas have long had anti-SLAPP legislation. And it's one of those things you gotta say, how far behind are we when? Dot, dot, dot. Okay, so we got lots of things to throw. Got lots of things to throw, and now is the time for it for all kinds of reasons. So we want to help people tell their stories. We want to point to what it is that we say that we need in order to protect these rights, as I say, that are a little outside of the usual realm of what we think of as an access to justice issue. Right? Again, counterintuitive. But when you explain it to anyone, 10 minutes, talk to your neighbor, whatever it takes, people get it. Because they know about the power of big resources. They know about the power of big resources to intimidate. And we need some mechanism to shield speech so that we can exercise our rights. So how about that? Thanks very much.